Yeah. Okay, here it is, people. This is number three on title as it is at the moment. Westlake Village, here we are. We are about to embark on the first track. We're going to proceed gallantly as we go along. Set up about setting a benchmark on each album, and the platform has risen and risen. And I had a lot of fun. Challenge was on this album. You give me the madness, I'll give you a sign.
Well, we've done three records in 3 years, and the first session was manic. The second session, we had 2 weeks, which actually is about 3 days too long. And this one is kind of in the middle of it. We did the whole record in 6 days, and we're out in Thousand Oaks, away from the distractions of Hollywood and away from Shangri-La Studio. So it's a lot different in a lot of ways.
I think we should steer clear of the dirge then and keep the rhythm.
Then why don't we go back to the original verse? Bow, bow, bow.
We have a good flow when we're all working together, and it just comes together fast. It's very fast paced. We all kind of know what everyone's doing, and it just comes together.
I think there's definitely the comfortable side of it is that we all know each other a lot more. We feel a lot more comfortable around each other. We're a lot more open. I feel a lot more open with giving in ideas, which I only kind of contributed a small part to two, and nothing to really one apart from just my playing. So this time I came in with a little bit more prepared and had some ideas that were floating around with me.
That's you?
Yeah.
Sounds great. Did you make a deal with the devil?
I think so.
At the corner?
I've been very, very pleased. They've been taken very well and everyone seems to like them. And we're all open to everybody's stuff, you know. There's some great stuff that Glenn's written.
I guess in this band, the band have chosen me to be the main songwriter, which I've been very honored to be. But like we bring stuff in, all of us bring ideas in. So I came to the studio at the Cave in Malibu and played Joe and Kevin. We can only do 5 songs that day because it's time, so I played them 5 songs. And that's the first time they're hearing them, you know. Don't you time on Black Country 3 for me was have to go in my studio and go a little deeper as far as the musical content.
Are you into that at all?
Yeah.
I like the riff.
Isn't that great?
I like that. Whatever the thing is you're doing.
It started off like this. Into Townsend today.
destination. I hear the grinding of the wheel. You keep me waiting at the station, and I want you to reveal. I got a steely-eyed devotion, and I'm ready for the thrill. Feel like I'm moving in slow motion as my car begins to spill.
I never like to really repeat myself, although there's a certain style of music that I think this genre, our band, should be in. But I, on this album, the songs were probably more important than the other two because of the platform that we've created.
Holy Mother, Lord and Maker, I am just a soldier of the free.
You know, I think we've grown as a band together. We're more accepting and more confident in the final product, having two records, you know, in the can already. And I think this one, honestly, musically so far, I think it's some of the strongest writing Glenn's done for any of these things.
Well, we're four people in the band and Kevin Shirley. It's never going to change. That's the way it is. So these four people, the collective of the four people with Kevin, I think is one once in a lifetime thing.
So 3, 4. You know, the old saying is democracy is a great thing as long as one person's in charge, you know, and you know, with this group, the dynamic is everybody has a say in it, but really we have to yield to Kevin because he's in charge of making the record.
Yeah, make it like, so it's not just a random slide, yeah. It's like a real part of it.
So, and he basically has final say on a lot of the arrangement things and a lot of the musically what we do, and that's good. You know, we need a ringleader because it would delve. There's a lot of ideas flowing from everybody, you know, me included, and it would kind of just dive into, you know, we would have. Is there such a thing as a four ring circus? Because that's what we would have, you know.
This band isn't about, you know, any tomfoolery or trickery. This is a very, very much alive band in the tradition of the great, great bands.
Chip 1.
Yeah.
It's gonna be awesome.
Yeah.
1, 2, 3.
You know, and let's be clear, I went about writing all these albums to sound like an early 70s thing. We didn't sort of like find ourselves like, oh my god, we went out of our way to be that way.
If we make a record that sounds like 1979, we've achieved it. I mean, I still think that's where we should be with the genre. You
everything
know.
I've brought in is in the ballpark of the first two albums.
And also, yeah, I'm also hearing this one. I'm also hearing this one as we get going, less layered than the first one.
Yeah.
It's written on your face.
stopped that kind of the creative side of myself for a long period of time. My own band, Bonham, I was writing, you know, co-writing with everybody. Did my own album, I co-wrote with a producer. But and that was a long time ago. Then I kind of just lost that spark. And I think what I always tend to do is I have to have someone to bounce it off. This is your time. I can come into this room with an unfinished idea, and within a couple of hours it can be finished. And that's what happened, you know, with the one song. I kind of just had the riff and like a hook chorus line.
One, two, verse, now.
Track tonight, yeah. To take home with you,
yeah,
and then you just take it to the hotel and sit with it. You're close. You don't even need help with the lyrics. You're close. Just feel confident about what you're doing and write it. Okay. And just come back in, take your time with it. You're really close.
Song.
You've got the scanning, you've got the melody, yeah. You're just a few lines short. You know what you want to say,
yeah.
So I you know.
I mean, Jason's brought a couple of great songs in on this album, so you know. And the good thing about Jason is he starts out on the last album with Save Me when he brought in. He had that. And he hadn't finished it. And I told him, let's finish it. And he was so excited by that. He was so blown away. And I said, Jason, you're more than a drummer, you're a great musician and a writer. And he went out and wrote a couple of great songs for this record, so.
And then one line, it was a great line, just what was it? I'm gonna die someday, and never that, you know. It really, you know, it doesn't really matter. Because I'll meet my maker with open arms. Just guess you're sat right there beside me. You know, it was my thing. I was like, I'll meet my maker with open arms. Cause look who's sat there beside him.
Do it. Dad, you know, write it.
It was about my dad.
Write it, kid.
Really, really happy for him, because Jason is. We all know about his drumming, but people need to know of what an amazingly talented musician and songwriter he is.
More so than not, I think. It becomes a situation where, you know, we enjoy each other's music personally. You know, we're all fans of each other's playing, and that respect permeates in the room, and you hear it on the tape.
In our ideas and bits, but it all has to make sense because, you know, Glenn's the singer and it has to be, you know, within his realm, so it makes sense and fit within the BCC mold.
You know, we all chip in, from Kevin to Derek to Joe to Glenn. We're very open. I'm very open with my suggestions. I was like, I'm not coming in with finished songs. I'm just coming in with like a melody idea or a guitar riff or a part. So that part of me, yeah, I have a computer full, still, of more ideas, but we're running out of time, so I'll save them for the next one.
always kind of had my own style on synthesizers. I'm kind of known for that, but especially now on this B3, I'm really digging in and developing my own sound, I can say confidently. And I think on this next record, it's undeniable that you'll be able to know it's me when you hear it. You know, everyone on their instrument, I think, does a great job. Gwen is a fantastic singer with amazing pedigree, if you will. And Joe is on fire doing what he does, and Jason just, you know, is heavy, plays so solidly, and the groove feels really good.
I think that's just that natural part of the way I play is always leading with the foot, basically. Like, I will follow the riff. More than play straight, I will follow a riff or a pattern with my foot. So if it's a riff, instead of playing straight through the riff, I'll be accenting the guitar part, which Dad did a lot. I don't plan to think of anybody in particular, but I do sometimes. I will actually make that decision. I will do a so-and-so here, or I will do a so-and-so. That would what so-and-so would do. And that's the way me and Kevin communicate. You've heard him when he goes, what would so-and-so do? What would your dad play there? Or what would that and there, you know? So we just have to call on the gods and say, I think it would be like this, you know?
You know, everyone thinks of your dad as a rock drummer, but essentially he was a soul drummer, yeah. Really. I mean, that's what his love
came from
was,
big
right?
Band, yeah. Came from big band, loved the soul stuff, but came from big band. You know,
right.
His idols were Buddy Rich and Jim Cooper and actually Lou Bellson and things, but came from that thing. That's why his drums sound the way they were. They were highly tuned.
And what's bizarre is that...
soul, you know, he loved all that old, you know, stuff.
And what's bizarre is that people that are trying to emulate that, it's the same thing with Jimmy. Everyone plays the whole thing is the whole lot of love. It's like, but the Led Zeppelin thing is, and this guy is everything other than that.
Yeah.
And the same with Bonzo. Just, you know,
if you don't know how funky he was or how...
Exactly.
Just like if you hear the drums to Whole Lot of Love, how funky it is and how... Dad's playing was very, it wasn't just a rock drummer. You can tell where he came from. He came from the era of the big band. My grandmother, God bless her, who passed away recently, last year, she was the woman who had to take him down to the big band, to the club where the big band played, and they would allow him to sit in. First thing he got was a snare drum when he was, I think, 13. He didn't get a drum kit till he was 16. Now you figure that out, folks. So from 16, he got his first drum kit. By 19, he did Led Zeppelin 1. In 3 years, he could play like that.
When I first opened up the Zeppelin tapes, when I heard what the kick drum was doing, that it never stopped.
So
it's playing all the time. There's no book.
And his left hand.
Like there's a whole internal groove going on there.
Give me 5 minutes, I'll take a start.
There's no ways you can sample that or even play like that.
It's like in rock and roll when he was doing that. Rock and roll, he's a two-handed. Yeah, I have to go. Richard stuff. That's where you go from. That's when you try and play, other people play rock and roll. You miss that.
It's all the internal swing.
Yeah, it is. I think one of the first things I ever did after he passed away was I went to my dad's record collection a few times just to get inspiration, you know, where he got it from. And then, you know, every time I would sit and talk with John Paul Jones or Jimmy, I would say, what would you listen to? What was Dad into, you know? And John Paul Jones said he used to come into my room many times to
soul records and R&B and you know, from the early rock and roll days to the blues guys to the I mean, I remember Freddie King being played full blast in the house a lot, and the track that Joe just played at the induction for Freddie King, actually. And he inspired me to go and buy it again because it reminded me of my dad driving in the south of France in a soft top Rolls Royce. I'm sat next to him and he had Freddie King Going Down written on. And I kept singing it because I kept thinking we were going to go over the cliff, we were going so fast. We're going to go down.
Solo record, generally you're pretty much living in the confines of where you normally would live musically. This sometimes trips me up a little bit. You know, I'm essentially a blues guitar player.
That country link? Okay, cool.
Glenn, I'd like to propose a slight change in direction. I know my solo records sometimes don't even reflect that. But essentially I'm a blues guitar player, and some of the rock stuff, you know, where my natural feel is, sometimes I'm a little bit behind it, you know, where I feel things a little bit, you know, almost like a blues format or a blues, you know, structure, where this is more on top of the beat, at every beat. You have to address every beat. So it can be quite taxing as a musician. And I'm I think Glenn Hughes is a masterful musician in every way. Obviously, he's known as one of the greatest rock singers of all time. You can't argue with that. That's in the history books. But a lot of people don't realize he's a world-class bass player as well. One of the best I've ever played with. One of the best I've ever heard, really. Plays that old Andy Frazier style to the T. And he's also a really great guitarist. His chord voicings and the way he finds notes. You know, I've learned a lot of chords from him, you know, because he has a tendency to put harmonics in a different place as opposed to on top, you put them on the bottom because of being a bass player.
Let's make that twice as long of an intro. Let's set a melody set.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I'm inspired by Glenn every time we get together and play, and inspired by Jason and Derek, and there's just a jet engine that when the pieces get in the room, that sound, it's like a jet engine. It's a rock band. It's a really talented rock band, and it's a good cast of characters overall.
For 6 years, maybe seven, and I know Joe's a good man, a good lad, a good student, a good scholar, and Joe's the kind of guy that will go on and always study till the day we pass, and same for me. he and I have the same ambition as musicians. We just want to learn. We shall sail. Holy Father,
believe it's over. Dusting down the last crusade. What we have here is my dear departed friend Mel Galley's 68 Les Paul Custom Black Beauty, which for those people that love Mel like I do, I was with Mel when he bought this guitar in 71 and in Texas, and this basically is the only guitar through Trapeze and into White, the early White Snake when Mel joined, that he wrote and played on. So when Mel passed, I was given the opportunity to be the caretaker of this guitar. Although it's mine, this is Mel's guitar, and I happen to just be the caretaker of it. Joe Bonamassa plays this guitar. He played it on Medusa on the first album, and he played it on a new song on this new album, which is untitled at the moment because I'm still coming up with the lyrics.
It's the nicest Les Paul custom I've ever bought. I'm not usually a fan of customs.
Are you serious?
Yeah, so it's f***ing wicked.
See?
That's why Mel played it for his whole life.
Yeah, yeah.
One, two, oh, one, two, three.
Holy Father, believe it's over. Dusting down the last crusade. Many miles, many tears for soldiers.
The last brigade on the motorcade.
Hello there, chaps. Friday morning. I'm driving to the studio. We are in the throes of BCC Dim number 3. We have a faint title, perhaps. We have 2, 4, 6, 7 new songs recorded and 2 songs left over from the last record, so we have 9. We have scheduled another 3 to record. But they're long songs, so they're not all going to make the record. We probably have 10 or 11 songs in the record. Some of them are 7 and 8 minutes long. And it's going great.
Holy Father, believe it's over. Dusting down the last crusade.
There's a little degree of poncing going on from the Royal Ponce, my Meister, as we call Glenn.
Let's be clear, right?
Derek is right? Tapping into the muse, and Joe's just giggling a lot, and Jason's dancing. He's actually got some very funny dance moves. And that's Black Country Communion, day 5. So look up, here it comes.
I'd worked with Kevin before, so I knew Kevin. I'd worked with Joe, so I knew Joe. Kevin brought me to work with Joe back in the You and Me album, Stella. And I'd met Glenn as a child. Derek, I don't know, I never met, even though he said I did once where I was really drunk and just totally forgot about him. But he just keeps going.
Kevin discovered me. I give Kevin a lot of credit.
He wants his keyboard turned up louder.
We're all very sarcastic, and there's like a lot of mockery, and we know each other well enough where we could take jabs at each other, but it's all in a loving way, you know.
Not only that, I was supposed to see that he was actually channeling from the muses.
Yes.
I was the first to notice that there was a halo around his fingertips.
Yes. And I'm always very grateful for that. And I'm hoping on this record that the halo will shine brighter and not be on such a dimmer.
We're like a family. It's like a very charismatic family. That's all I can say about this.
I am the Ponce, by the way, and all these other chaps are my lovely, lovely, lovely friends. Thank you for sharing. Now, I wanted to be in a band with a foundation of a family-orientated business where there's no skeletons and there's no baggage. This is the band I chose to be in because we're really good friends.
This band has been explosive from the minute we got in the room. And once again, you have to give credit to Kevin Shirley to seeing it going, the drum chair should be Jason Bonham. The keyboard chair should be Derek Schwinn. And it was basically Glenn Hughes, myself, and Kevin in a room going, let's try to get the supergroup thing happening, and let's see who's into it, you know, and here we are.
Sat in with Joe Bonamassa at a performance at House of Blues, and then Kevin said, we have to put a band around you guys. We went up into the studio. It was supposed to just be an experiment. Let's put some tracks down in here. All of a sudden, it turned into a week-long recording. Probably made a whole record, and no one was just like thinking. There was no plan, no name of a band or anything, but then it just really turned into something. And now here we are 3 years later, three records in.
Studio such as this, and Jason and Derek come in, and they're hearing the songs for the first time. Now, this may have been that way back in the day as well with a lot of other bands from the 70s, where, you know, they didn't write in a group, or some people wrote in a group. Purple used to write in a group situation, and Zeppelin used to write in a group situation, but Townsend didn't. He'd bring the songs in and they would learn them. And with this band, because of everybody's schedules, we don't have the time to woodshed and you know, jam, you know, which is kind of a shame. But that's not who we are. Black Country Communion is exactly what it started out being, and that's the road we've been, you know, trailblazing. So, but what this band has done for me as a songwriter is given me a new lease on life, as far as really, really enjoying the process of writing songs. About the, when the verse and the pre-chorus comes, everything else, and everything is done like that.
I love that about Kevin, that he likes to capture that band vibe, and as opposed to just having it be a science project where everyone puts in their tracks and mails their tracks in or whatever.
Here's a stop. 3, 4.
1. I think the stop should be on an up note.
1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2.
again, we've gone back to our old ways of 7 days, even not even 6 days, and that's it. Finished, apart from mixing. So yeah, it's a great process.
And what can you say about Jason, Glenn, and Derek, and Kevin? You know, masterful musicians, all of them. And it's a real challenge to be in the band. And it's like they bring the best out of me, and they test me every track. The other records, you know, well, it's probably on par with the first one. It's not as heavy as the second record. We kind of veered into this heavy metal territory on a couple of those songs, and I'm not really sure that's where we need to be. I think where we are right now, you know, being a throwback early 70s style British rock band is fun. It's fun for me.
There's a secret place, it's where
really, really looking forward to recording the song Afterglow. It's a song that I wrote around Christmas, and it's been sort of sitting with me ever since, and I've been wanting to get it out. And it's a song that signals who we are today. And but you know, there are many moments on Black Country 3 that signatures that people will understand of what we are, but there are also new nuances and quirk, a little quirkiness in the songs that are new to us, because we've got to branch out a little bit, we've got to explore, and every great band that I admire have done that. You know, every great rock and roll band, or any band in or any singer or musician, has to challenge themselves. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't.
You know, I feel kind of sad today. It's been a great fun. It just seems to, just we really start to get kicked in. It's like we're coming to an end. But or is it just the beginning?
We've just finished the Black Country Communion album. We have a tentative title. We have 12 songs in the can, and they're not going to all make the album because it's a long album, and the songs are long. Some of them stretching to 8 and 9 minutes. It was been a long week, long and intense week, and everyone played great. Jason played great. Jason, he was sick for a couple of days, but he powered through. Glenn played great. Everyone played great. And I think it went really well. I think we have a lot of music in the style that we really wanted to make when we put the band together. You know, when we first put the band together, we considered Free and Deep Purple and Led Zeppelin as the backbone of what the music should sound like. I think on the second record we might have gone a little heavier than that, which served everybody well. But I think we've backed off that a little bit and gone back to the spirit of the 70s, I guess, in the music, which really is what we all love. And I think it's stronger. I think the songs are more cohesive than the first and second album. And I think I haven't heard the final vocals at this point. I haven't heard the final melodies that Glenn and I will work on when he's finished with the lyrics. But musically, I think it's a very, very cohesive album. And I think it's going to fit the bill just very nicely. Black Country Communion, Afterglow.
No, just let it before even before the vocal comes in.
So.
So you go. That's two. one line, two of the high lines.
Yeah.
And so there's like five. I think.
Okay.
So
two.
So
two.
Up there, and we can come out of the heavy and just come back into that and let it, you know, almost like rain songy, where you come back into the da-da-da, before the house comes back in, and then afterglow.
None of this stuff is going to be recorded, obviously.
But we won't let that on the camera.
Why not?
Edit!